But, and this is the truth, I even went up to him before the meeting and said, do you got something I could say? Any little tit? And he didn't have anything nice to say about himself. Well, I'm at a loss. But I met Charlie this weekend, and I know him. Just as if I would have talked to any one of you for a few moments. Because when you say things like home group, sponsorship, sponsees, and service, I know you. I know who you are. And that's who Charlie is.
Hi, everybody. Had a little wardrobe crisis there. My glasses buried themselves in my coat. Let's get up some bookkeeping going here. Then I'm going to try to live up to that glowing introduction. Everybody, I'm Charlie Parker. I'm alcoholic. I'm going to warn you in advance. I'm a big guy. I ride Harleys. I shoot shotguns competitively, and I'm liable to cry like a little girl in a pink dress up here at any moment. I was telling Sharon yesterday. I said, you know, after this weekend, I'm spring loaded. I think I got a hair trigger on my cry button. You know, because this has been a very emotional weekend for us. You know, we're here to celebrate Founders Day of Alcoholics Anonymous right here in the city of Akron, Ohio, and if he was still alive, Dr. Bob would be picking up an 80-year chip a couple of days ago. I'm a big fan of AA history. I love everything that comes. I have no illusions about, you know, what power is keeping me sober and where it came from and the people that came before us to keep the lights on. I want to thank guys like James and Bob P. out there, you know, who were the last couple of guys standing in the countdown last night. And at 48 and 57 years of sobriety, 58, still attending AA and still trying to help drunks. You know, we're very fortunate in AA today. We got meetings everywhere, but that, you know, I don't ever want to lose sight of the fact that we see clearly in AA today because we stand on the shoulders of giants that came before us. We're eating fruit from a tree that we didn't plant, and we're drinking water from a well we didn't dig, and I am so grateful to the people that came before us. I can't even tell you. I am one guy that's real clear on the idea that the program of Alcoholics Anonymous saved my life and the lives of several others. And my family thanks you, and everybody I know thanks you. I want to thank the committee. I want to thank everybody that had anything to do with having putting this thing on. If you've been involved in stuff like this, you know there's just an awful lot of work that goes into putting a deal like this on. And I want to thank everybody that had anything to do with it. And if it's like the people that I grew up in AA with, there's also a lot of people that didn't do a darn thing. But we have a lot of ideas about how it could have been done just a little bit better, you know. For them, there'll be space on the upcoming committees, you know. But I want to thank everybody. That, you know, Jeff has been an amazing host. Jeff and Raquel have shown us around this weekend. We've known Jeff from before, and I sponsor his sponsor. I've got sponsees here. I talked to my sponsor this morning, and you know, it's just an awful lot going on here. The speakers that have come before have just done such an amazing job. I mean, you know, Howard on Friday night. I just love Howard. Howard and I have a special thing going on, you know, and we've been picking at each other for years, trying to get each other straightened out on the fourth step. And that, you know, he was making comments. We go back and forth, whether it's three column, four column, and we talked probably another hour on it yesterday. And the thing that came to me in the midst of all that is that whether we agree or disagree, I got to have a conversation about how to work the fourth step with one of my heroes. Woo, it's about right here. Usually I can feel it coming about here, and you know, and Katie always says that I'll usually pound the podium two or three times, and then I go, well, I didn't see that coming, you know, but I'm just warning you, it could be ugly. I'm not off my medication. I'll try not to just bawl up here, but woo! Yeah, if you can't feel it today, you can't feel it, brother. It was a real honor to get to go to the archives over there. It has been like the life work of Gail. And where's Gail? Where's Gail? Right there. You know, that's an amazing job she's done over there. She's been an amazing gift to the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. And, you know, you got to ask yourself, you know, she sat there and she said, is there anything I can do? And that lady came up with something for her to do, and she's been doing it for 40 years, 20 years. And, you know, you got to ask yourself, who's going to be the next one? You know, if somebody says there's something you can do, are you there to do it? That's what we got to do around here. We're the next generation of Alcoholics Anonymous, and we got to keep this thing going. I want to, you know, I think, it was great to hear Howard speak Friday night, and then the A.A. Al-Anon pair, and then we got to go to her Gail's traditions thing yesterday morning, and then we came in here and heard the old timers panel. Those guys did a great job, and then got to hear another one of my heroes, Sharon Crane. Everybody, you know, and Sharon, I know there's a special shout out for you from the boys from Philadelphia. Where are they at? All right. They said they didn't get a chance to show you their propers yesterday, but I love you, and Sharon and I, one of the real joys of getting to do this a little bit is you get to see people that you love. You know, you look up at the ticket and you go, oh my God, it's Howard and it's Sharon and it's Gail and it's all these people that you love, and then you got old friends and new friends. And for those of y'all that were here last year, my wife spoke here last year, and stand up, Katie. Yeah. And Katie's my best friend in AA. She's the best AA I know. And you know, I got to tell you, though, you know, the kind of ego we got going in our house is she was a little surprised because she thought they were holding that space for a banner for her up there. And no, I'm just kidding. Katie, you know, I love to hear Katie talk. For those of you that heard Katie talk last year, my talk and Katie's talk are a lot alike. Both of us talk a lot about Katie. And but it's a real honor in our family. I want to tell you, AA is alive and well in our home, and to have both of us get to speak at Founders Day is not lost on us. The Parkers are most grateful to the Founders Day Committee and getting to be here. My sobriety date is March 22nd of 1985, and that's I'm sober just over 30 years. I'm 50. I want to thank you. I have a sponsor. His name is Myers R. Before, I've been a benefactor of a lot of good sponsorship. I was sponsored by Myers. I was sponsored by Larry J., who is sick right now. We need to pray for Larry Johnson. And then Mark Houston really changed my life, and I hope we're going to get the chance to talk about that. And then I was with Jim Fletcher for 17 years before that. So I've been very fortunate to have some good sponsors. I'm fortunate to get to sponsor some guys. I sponsor an awful lot of guys. And I just love every one of them. There's some of them here, and it's a real honor to get to be involved. And then we got some friends here from Canada and all over. So it's just been great. But my job here is to talk about what I was like, what happened, and what I'm like now. And you know, in AA, we talk about coming out of your own experience. You know, and it always reminds me. I like to start off with a little joke. Because when we talk about coming out of our experience, it reminds me of this guy that was driving down a little farm-to-market road one day, and he's driving past this farmhouse, and he looks over, and there's a sign on the fence post, and it says, "Talking dog for sale." And he can't stand it. He goes up to the farmhouse, and this old farmer's sitting there on the porch whittling, and he goes, "So you got a talking dog?" And the guy goes, "Yeah, he's around back." And he wanders around back, and this old red hound dog is laying there, about like that one laying right there. And he says, He looks at the dog and he says, "So you can talk?" And the dog says, "Well, I certainly can." And he goes, "How on earth did that happen?" And the dog says, "Well, when I was young, I started picking up some language skills. And as I got older, I started developing some of the nuances of the language. I started working with slang and colloquialisms and that sort of thing. And, you know, it's really just, it's built into an amazing life for me." He said, "I had a 19-year career with the Drug Enforcement Administration. And I was able to infiltrate some scenes that no human agent would have ever been able to get into." And he says, "You know, I've stayed in some of the finest hotels of the world. And I've eaten the cooking of some of the greatest chefs of the world." He says, "But you know, enough about me. What's really interesting, some of my pups have developed foreign language skills. And I have two pups that are in the United Nations right now as foreign delegates." And it's just been an amazing life for me. And the guy says, "My God, it's been fascinating talking to you." And he goes back where that farmer's sitting. He goes, "My God, man." He goes, "How much do you want for a dog like that?" And the guy goes, "I don't know. $40? And he goes, "Why on earth would you sell a fabulous dog like that for $40? And the guy goes, "None of that stuff he told you is true. You know?" Here, it doesn't really matter how good the story is if it's not my experience. Well, drunks can smell BS from a mile away. I grew up in Dallas, Texas. I live in Austin, Texas now. My home group is the Primary Purpose Group of Alcoholics Anonymous, and we invite you to come see us on a Tuesday night. If you're ever in Austin on a Tuesday night, we meet at 7:30 at the Faith United Methodist Church, and we'd love to show you the kind of hospitality you've shown here. But we have a big book study meeting. It's a very intense big book study. And we have the amazing thing about it is we have on a Tuesday night about 225 people showing up for a big book study. I like to say that AA is making a big comeback in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. I come from a pretty normal family. I grew up in Dallas. I grew up during the baby boom. I was born in 1956. I was a year old when Bob rolled into his first meeting back there. I mean, it's just amazing to me. But I grew up during the baby boom. And when I say I come from a normal family, I don't know exactly what a functional family looks like, but I know I've heard enough fifth steps over the years to know that there's a lot of people that had it just one heck of a lot worse than I did. Nobody was drinking in my house. I grew up Southern Baptist. Whatever it is, we're against it. I can relate to these people on the back rows because it's just like the church I grew up in, where the parking lot fills up from the front to the back and the church filled up from the back to the front. You know, you had to get here early to get a seat in the back, you know. My mother was a school teacher for 42 years. My mother taught first grade for 42 years, and I was darn well prepared for the first grade, I got to tell you. I kind of crushed it, too, you know. I mean, first grade went pretty good for me. And my dad was a forklift salesman. He was a salesman most of his life. But, you know, I did grow up with a couple of things going on. I did have a sister that was perfect. I had a sister that was National Honor Society, first chair flautist, drum majorette, you name it, she was there. You know, did I say National Honor Society? And then I was this kind of thuggish little brother. But I did grow up, coming from a bunch of educators, I did grow up under the burden of potential. Anybody else go up hearing about your potential? Oh my God, it was like, you know, why can't you, you know, apply yourself? Why can't you be more like Charles Mollier across the street, you know? And I remember thinking, well, that's flattering, Mom, thank you, but I'm really not holding back that much, you know? Kind of getting my best shot here. But, you know, none of that stuff made me an alcoholic. I think a lot of us get here trying to figure out why we're alcoholic, you know? I mean, what is it that made me an alcoholic? Why did I have to get so loaded? And I'm not even sure, looking back, how important it is. You know, it's kind of like if you're out in the jungle and you're in the woods and you're wandering along and you look up and a mountain lion is poised to pounce on you, it doesn't really matter how he got there, you know? It's like, it's not like you're going to go, well, that's peculiar. They're not common to this region, you know? You know, what's he doing here, you know? What is it that made me an alcoholic? I like to say that I've been given the greatest gift that God can give a hopeless alcoholic like me, and that is full recovery from the hopeless state of mind and body that we show up here with. My sponsor is a bookbinder, and all this is right here is a large print copy of the big book that he bound for me. It's the first 164 pages and Dr. Bob's stories and the appendices, and that's it. It's one of my most prized possessions. I like to say I'm a big book guy. I'm an unapologetic big book thumper. You know, it's so funny. You hear people all the time going, well, I'm no big book quoter, or I'm not going to give you page numbers. And, you know, and I'm sitting there going, oh no, please don't do that. You know, we'd much rather you take the meeting hostage for the next 10 minutes talking about your divorce one more time, you know. Please don't talk about the book, you know. I was like, that's just... But the first promise in the big book is right here on the title page. It says the story of how many thousands of men and women have recovered from alcoholism. So already on the first page of the big book, I'm hearing stuff that's different from what I've been hearing in the meetings for a while. But if we're going to talk about having recovered, what are we talking about having recovered from? Because it does say that I have a daily reprieve based upon my spiritual condition. But the thing we're talking about recovering from is this, in the foreword of the first edition, it says, we of Alcoholics Anonymous are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. And I like to take just a minute talking about what we mean by that. As an alcoholic, what makes me an alcoholic is I have two problems with alcohol. One happens to me when I drink it. One happens to me when I don't drink it. Other than that, I don't struggle with alcohol. I'm so glad y'all get that. Sometimes the guys at the detox center don't get that one, you know. They're like, when do we smoke, you know? But you know what? I go out there every Monday and I tell them the same thing, because I figure I got four shots at that guy. And if a guy gets out of treatment and he knows what it means to be an alcoholic and whether or not he is one, in my mind, that treatment's been a success. Because I spent a lot of time in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous raising my hand saying, I'm Charlie Parker and I'm alcoholic, and I had no idea what it meant. I knew that if there was such a thing as an alcoholic, I must be one, and because I'd had a lot of trouble from drinking, and I knew I didn't know anybody that drank more than I did. I've met some now, but some of you guys are impressive. You know, I mean, we're the only fellowship that, you know, a guy can come and go, yeah, I got arrested and I had a 4.1 blood alcohol level, and we're all nudging each other, going, that's pretty good right there. Yeah, 0.8. I used to wake up with a 0.8. You know, I mean. But what does it mean to be an alcoholic? What are we talking about? You know, and it's funny, we act like we know what that means. But as the first piece of it is the physical aspect of alcoholism that the book describes in the doctor's opinion in the first 23 pages, and that's that I have a physical reaction that's different to alcohol from most people. When I drink vodka, something happens that ain't regular. What happens to me is it triggers a physical reaction that the book calls the phenomenon of craving. When I introduce alcohol into my system, and that's the part I'm not willing to test today, is what would happen to me if I introduced alcohol into my system. Because I know from my experience and from what my book tells me, and what the book tells me, is that I have a physical reaction that manifests in an allergy, and that symptom of that allergy is this phenomenon of craving. It triggers a drink. And the most important thing you can do with anything I say or anything this book says is hold it up against your experience and ask yourself, what happens when you drink? Because when I drink, I can't tell you how much I'm going to drink or when I'm going to stop with any predictability. And I don't have to read that from this book. I can look back over my experience and what happens when I drink. And it talks about this phenomenon of craving. And I love the way Tina mentioned last night where it says men and women drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol. You know, I stopped at Sharon. I want to give a shout out to Tina last night. What a good job last night. I also wanted to say thank you to the signers. We have guys here signing for the. That's a wonderful thing. And I don't know if they announced this from the committee, but next year they're working on trying to get somebody in here that can interpret for people that can hear but won't listen. This thing that happens when I drink alcohol, it's a big problem. It always gets away from me. I can't control what happens when I start drinking. But it's not my biggest problem. If my biggest problem was what happens when I drink 4 ounces of vodka, what would my solution be? Don't drink vodka, right? Just say no. I love where Sharon said she grew up during the... It wasn't just say no, it was just say thanks. That's classic. I'm going to give you credit for that the first 3 times I use it. It's a big problem, but it's not my biggest problem. And the thing I never thought about for a long time about thinking about this phenomenon of craving piece of alcoholism that it talks about on Roman numeral 28 was that every time I ever took the first drink, every time I took that drink that triggered the phenomenon of craving, every time I took that drink that set me off on another run, I was stone cold sober. I can't blame the first drink on being loaded. This is the second piece of alcoholism, and that's that I make the craziest decision in my life, the decision to try to take another run at this thing. I make that decision stone cold sober because I get so uncomfortable sober. So what happens, and you think about it, we act like people know this, but think about when you were coming here. You remember when you would promise people that you're never going to drink again, and they'd look up and you got a drink in your hand, and they'd always ask you that question. They'd go, why did you start drinking again? And we'd give them the only answer we got, which is what? I don't know, man. I don't know. I swear to God, this is maybe the biggest room I've ever said that in, but it's like a chorus in Alcoholics Anonymous. Everybody knows the answer to that question, and it's, I don't know, man. God Almighty, I don't know. It's just what I do, I mean, when I hurt people, I make promises, I don't keep them. And by the time I get to the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous, I think there's something wrong with me. I'm like, disease my eye. There is something wrong with me because I hurt people that I care about greatly. And that's the powerlessness piece of this alcoholism, is that I got a mind that gets so uncomfortable sober that I'm eventually going to need relief. And when I need relief, I can't think about what's going to happen if I drank or what happened the last time I drank. Real alcoholics don't stay sober because of consequences. We don't stay sober because of what happened the last time we drank. We don't stay sober because of what's going to happen this time we're going to drink. And we don't stay sober because what we hear in the war stories in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous. When we get a new guy in there and go, oh, let's do a step one meeting, and everybody starts talking about all the bad stuff that happened to him, we should be pulling this guy with the hope of recovery on the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. Because trying to scare this guy into stopping drinking is a futile effort. It's not like I'm going to be, when it's on me and when I need relief, it's not like I'm going to be in the liquor store and going, oh, wait a minute, remember what happened to Wallace? I don't want any of that, It won't work. It'll work, like so many of our plans, it works right up till it quits working, So What happens? The book describes a terrible cycle. And what happens for a guy like me is I drink until I have to stop. And then after I stop for a while, I get so uncomfortable that I have to drink again. So I drink until I have to stop, and I stop until I have to drink. And I drink until I have to stop, and I stop until I have to drink. And that's the way it shows up for me. The book talks about, I started drinking when I was 16 years old. I started drinking when I was 13. I got drunk a few times when I was 13, but I didn't really get started drinking until I was 16. And I used to think that was young to start drinking, you know. And heck, now it's not even young to stop anymore, you know. I mean, you know, I got much love for young people in AA, but I mean, I started drinking at 16, and I probably didn't need you people until I was like 17, you know, but... But you know, this thing about, I'm a big believer in singleness of purpose, and I want to take just a second to talk about what we mean by singleness of purpose. Because the thing about Alcoholics Anonymous is we are a one-trick pony. We are alcoholics helping alcoholics, and we don't try to be all things to all people. And the reason we talk, and when I came in, I heard people saying, oh, you can't talk about drugs over at the so-and-so club, and people were saying, well, you know, drugs are part of my story, and of course now I'm looking at it the other way, and I'm going, well, I bet there's parts of your fifth step that were, or your sex inventory that are part of your story, and you don't feel so compelled to share those from the podium, you know, but that's just me, you know, I judge no man, but the thing with singleness of purpose is, and nobody ever really broke it down for me. And the reason we talk about it is because, not because we're trying to keep the filthy dope fiend out of our AA meetings, you know. It's like, because I have deep, deep experience with outside issues. But we're not going to talk about those today, because I'm an alcoholic speaking in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous. And the reason we talk about that is on page 18. It says... It talks about how we'll go into a psychiatrist or a doctor. We've got to be the only group of people that will pay a psychiatrist $200 an hour and then lie to him the whole time. You know? I mean, if he says, do you drink? I'm going to go, oh, yeah, yeah. I might have a couple of beers if I'm mowing the yard or something. You know what I mean? Like I've mowed the yard lately, you know? But it says, strangely enough, wives, parents, and intimate friends find us even more hard to approach than do the doctor or the psychiatrist. Now here's where it gets interesting. It says, but the ex-problem drinker who has found our solution, who is properly armed with the facts about himself, can generally win the entire confidence of another alcoholic in a few hours. It says, until such an understanding is reached, little or nothing can be accomplished. Somebody said it from this podium yesterday, that every one of us in this room who's found this recovery program had a moment when they identified with another alcoholic. And it says, until such an understanding is reached, little or nothing can be accomplished. What are they? That identification of one alcoholic working with another one is so important that until it's reached, little or nothing can be accomplished. So it's so important. Out of all the 12-step programs that are out there, and there's a bunch of them, as you know, and thank God for them, but I mean, there's Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, Gamblers Anonymous, Overeaters Anonymous, Debtors Anonymous. I even heard there's a Lip Balm Addicts Anonymous, you know, in case anybody's ever suffered from that heartbreaking malady. But you know, every time I say that, I see somebody out there with their Carmex going, oh, I feel you, brother. I know. We watched a speaker one time that had her Carmex in her hand the whole time. I bet she applied it 18 times. During the talk, I'm like, oh my God, we got another fellowship for you, lady. But out of all those fellowships, the only difference in any of them is the first half of the first step and the middle part of the 12th step. What I'm powerless over and who I carry the message to. That's how important that identification. If it wasn't for that identification factor, we'd all meet in the same room. But that identification is so important that until it's reached, little or nothing could be accomplished. That's why we have... So. Hopefully you'll never hear any of my sponsees say I'm an alcoholic and anything, because it doesn't apply. When we're in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous, we're identifying as alcoholic with alcoholic. If I go to another 12-step fellowship, I'll identify in that fellowship. It's worth knowing, because it's not just that we're mad at them, or it's that we're desperate that they find the room that they identify in as much as I identify in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, because we want everybody to find the solution. Well, one of my favorite examples of that is we Katie and I get to do this a lot, and one of my favorite things is when we get to go into a new town, a lot of times they'll say, you know, Ernie's going to come pick you up at the airport, and I'll be talking to him on the phone, you know, and he'll say, okay, listen, hey, I'm gonna be, and maybe I say somebody I haven't met, you know, and they'll say, he'll say, you know, I'm going to be in baggage claim, and I'm like 5'10". I go, don't even tell me, just be in baggage claim. And I can't even tell you how many times Katie and I have come down the escalator, and you're coming out of the, and you walk, you come down the escalator, and you look around, and you go, there's our boy right there, you know. And you walk up, and you go, are you Ernie? And he goes, yeah, how's he doing? And you're like, right there, buddy. I mean, that's why geographic cures don't work for me, because you can set me down in San Francisco, and in 30 seconds, I can look around and go, he looks like he parties, you know, and off we go, you know. I mean, it's funny, we spend all this time trying not to be an alcoholic, and then, you know, now when Katie and I meet people, our biggest compliment to anybody we can meet at a weekend like this is when you go, oh, I'd have drank with that guy, you know. I mean, you know that feeling? I mean, you know, I met this guy, Andre, from Louisiana. I'm like, oh, I'd have gone to jail with Andre, you know. And we'd have been sitting in jail going, that was awesome, you know. Oh my God. So anyway, I started drinking about 16, and it starts getting worse, man. It starts getting sloppy, and after a while, I started losing the power of choice and control. I couldn't choose how much I was going to drink, or when I was going to drink, or how much I was going to drink once I got started. And the book talks about it on page 24. It says, at a certain point in the drinking of every alcoholic, he passes into a state where the most powerful desire to stop drinking is of absolutely no avail. Right? We all know the only requirement for membership in Alcoholics Anonymous is what? A desire to stop drinking. But on page, a desire to stop drinking will get me a front row seat in any AA meeting in the world. But right there on page 24, it tells me it won't do a darn thing to keep me sober. It says, I pass into a state where the most powerful desire to stop drinking is of absolutely no avail. My topic today is the second surrender, and I swear I'm going to try to get around to it. But we got to talk about this first surrender right now. And it says, the fact is that most alcoholics have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. I am unable at certain times, to call into my consciousness with sufficient force the memory of the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. I'm without defense against the first drink. And that doesn't matter whether that's my suffering and humiliation or my family's suffering and humiliation. When it comes time for relief, I can't call it into mind. And the way I like to illustrate that is, I was a big fan of pawn shops. Any other pawn shoppers here today? My man, right back there. All right. I loved pawn shops. I loved everything about it. I loved the whole equation of pawn shops. There was a purity to it that, you know, I don't ever remember a pawnbroker going, good God, man, weren't you just in here this morning? You know, or, you know, what are you going to do with this money, you know, or anything? It wasn't like that. You just give them the shotgun and they give you the money, and you give them the deer rifle and they give you the money. Now, I should mention that I didn't own very much stuff. So I was having to pawn stuff that didn't belong to me. And, you know, we drunks, we make some really good plans. We really do. I mean, we make plans that you could take right here to the business department at the University of Akron and show it to them, and they'd look it over and go, that's a pretty solid plan right there, you know. I mean, and you know, and our plans work right up to the point that they quit working, you know. And what happened for me was, I had this plan where I would pawn this stuff. I was pawning stuff in my parents' house, and I should tell you now. I know you hear some sad stories from the podium, Alcoholics Anonymous. But I was so poorly treated as a child that I ran away from home for good at the age of 28. I'm not kidding either. Never went back. But you know, I'm pawning this stuff, but I'm not selling it. I'm just pawning it, and I'm rolling it every 90. I had 90 days to get something out, but I would try to pull something in 90 days that would get everything out, and that worked for a good while, right up till it quit working. But what happened was one time I pulled a little scam, a little insurance scam, and I don't want to give anybody any ideas, But I get enough money to get everything out of the pawn shop, and I'm a blackout drinker. I used to drink at the Spillway Pub there in East Dallas, and this was before I moved to Austin. And they would let me run a tab. It was the only place in Dallas that would let me run a tab. So I get the money, and I'm going to go get everything out of the pawn shop. But it's also really important to settle your tab at my equivalent of the Tattletale Lounge. It was the Spillway Pub there in Dallas. And you know, I love that place. And, you know, it just smelled like beer and cigarettes and urine and just... Oh, God, so Katie and I were down on 6th Street in Austin one morning during the Pecan Street Festival, and the smell of this bar came rolling out through the doors, and I was just like, God, I love that. You know, I mean, just... Sorry, I'm going off on a little bunny trail there for a minute, but, you know... I go to settle my tab, and I'm not gonna, you know, this thing, when we talk about the phenomenon of craving and the manifestation of an allergy, I never talk like that. Anything I tell you like that is stuff I've learned since I get here. I never walked into the Spillway Pub, you know, and, you know, wandered up to the bar and went, oh, Bobby, God Almighty, spiritual malady is on me today, you know. Yeah. I had a beer on the way over here, and it has triggered a phenomenon of craving that is just, you know. I just go in and order a beer, and the next thing I know is I come out of a 5-day blackout this time. I had a lot of blackouts, but I didn't have many of these. This was 5 days of don't remember nothing. And I come out of this blackout, and I'm sitting on the edge of the bed upstairs at my parents' house, and I can still tell you the color of the carpet, the temperature of the room, because I'm sitting on the edge of that bed, and I realize that in this pocket I got $8, and in this pocket I still got all those pawn tickets. And we've all had those mornings where you just go, oh no. Because I shot everything I had on that one scam, and now I got nothing. And my dad was a good man. My dad worked hard for his stuff. Nobody was giving him his stuff, and I wasn't a sociopath. I knew I wasn't going to sell my dad's shotgun for $40, and I would have to go to my dad and go, Dad, listen, if we act now, I can get you a relatively good deal on all your stuff, you know, but if we wait till tomorrow, it's strictly retail, you know. And are there any Al-Anons in the room today? God bless the Al-Anons. Most of us would be dead if it wasn't for an Al-Anon in our lives. And believe me, for the Al-Anons in the room, we know that's not funny. But if I touch the shame and desperation of that morning of having to go to my father, who was a good man, and tell him, Dad, we got to go to the pawn shop, because what would happen on that day, I guarantee if I touch that shame, I won't be able to finish the talk, because what happened... That was the lowest of the low for me, because what would happen was now we got to go to the pawn shop. But it wasn't just we're going to go to the pawn shop. Dallas is a big spread out town like Los Angeles. And it was like we got to go down on Buckner Boulevard and get your shotgun. And we got to go to East Grand and get your deer rifle. And I left the Sterling Silver in Oak Cliff, and your metal detectors are out on Garland Road. And we got to go to Mesquite to get the, you know, and it was all day in the car with me and my dad. And all that shame. And when we'd be riding in that car, I remember saying, Dad, I swear to God, I will never do this again. I don't want to feel like this again. I don't want you to feel like this again. I swear to God, I will never do this again. And if I was lying to that man, I darn sure didn't know it, because it felt like I meant it with every fiber of my being, that I will never do this again. What I didn't know riding in the car with my dad that day was that I didn't have the power to make good on that promise. When I was promising him that I was never going to do that again, I might as well promise you people that I'm going to flap my arms up here and fly around this room and come back and land on this stage, because I did not have the power to make good on the promise that I was never going to drink again. The way I'm reading the book these days, it seems to me, when I'm working with a new guy in step one, I don't talk about unmanageability as like, can you balance your checkbook or keep a job or something. The thing it seems to be looking for in the first step, the way I'm reading it today, and I might feel differently next year, but it seems like it says, can you or can you not manage the decision to not drink when you honestly want to? And if you can't, then you may be suffering from an illness which only a spiritual experience will conquer. Only? The reason the book spends the doctor's opinion in the first 44 pages of the book, almost half of our recovery text, is spent on step one, is because I'm not going to give a flip about a power greater than myself until I have a crushing experience that my own power is not going to get the job done. Why would I care about a power greater than myself if I still think I can do this thing? You know, that's why we spend so much time on step one, and that's why I think it's a mistake to us. I've heard people say before, you know, you work the first step getting here. That was not my experience. I think we have to take time to qualify this guy and let him know what he's got and what we got, and then let him decide if he wants what we have and are willing to go to any lengths to get it. Well, after the pawn shops, that's how slick I was. That's how cool I was. That's the guy that arrived on the doorsteps of Alcoholics Anonymous on March 22nd of 1985. I was a burden to my family and anybody that was unfortunate enough to be associated with me or care about me. And what happened is, and I want to get moving now, because in the 3 hours I have left, I figure since it's the last talk, you know, I don't have to, and there's no time limit. No, actually, my job is, you guys have been so brought on such a high from this weekend, I'm supposed to just bring you down to a point where you don't leave out of here hugging trees and stuff, you know. But you know, what happened for me was I came to AA, and I've got some stuff I really want to say here, because I'm about to get to, that's the first surrender, is the surrender to alcoholism. And that's the way I showed up here. And then, you know, the first surrender is pretty easy, because it's pretty easy to surrender when a gorilla's got his foot on your throat. You know, the easy part of the step one is it comes fresh off of butt kicking, you know. So, but what happened for me was I came in and I was going to a lot of meetings. I did 90 meetings in 90 days. I got a sponsor. We were going through the steps, but I missed an awful lot. And not of any fault of anybody on our own, you know. Before I go any further, I'll love Jim Fletcher for the rest of my life. That man opened his life to me. He taught me things about character and dignity and wearing, you know, the reason I got a coat and tie on up here tonight is because Jim said when you get behind the podium of Alcoholics Anonymous, you're wearing a coat and tie. He said, it's okay if you don't want to wear a coat and tie. And I was like, oh, good. He goes, I mean, you still have to wear one. But if you want to do it under protest, that'll be just fine. You know, I mean, you know, but I mean, all of my experience on the way to you people in a coat and tie had one simple job, and that was to stand there and go, no contest, Your Honor. I come into AA, and the reason I like to talk about Jim is because I don't wait till you can do this stuff perfectly to start sponsoring people. It's my firm belief that if the sponsor and the sponsee are both giving it their best shot, God takes up a lot of slack in that deal. You'll learn more about sponsoring people somewhere along the line. It seems like sponsoring people has become optional. You know, it's one of our steps. You know, like Tina said last night, you don't give it away to keep it. You got to give it away to get it. It's part of what we do. But I'm hoping to, you know, other thing I got to tell you is I got some pretty serious attention deficit disorder going up here. I go off on a little bunny trail sometimes, and there'll be times where I'll say, we're going to get back to that later. And what that means is that this is not the appropriate time to be talking about the 12th step right now. But when I tell you we're going to get back to it later, we're probably not coming back, you know. I always get real excited when I actually circle back around to one. But, you know, what happened, though, was I missed an awful lot, you know. And Mark Houston used to like to say, how do you know what you don't know? Mark Houston came into our lives and changed our lives. And I will never forget the man that Mark Houston was. And he died unexpectedly in 2010. And God bless you, Mark Houston. The power of God was delivered to me through a man named Mark Houston, and I can barely say his name without crying. But I went through the work. Mark taught me to work a lot with this prayer called the set-aside prayer. And we do a little prayer before I read the book and before I go into the work where I just say something like, God, please help me to set aside everything I think I know about myself, alcoholism, AA, the big book, and even you, God, so that I can have a new experience. Help me to see the truth. Because I don't know if this happens for you guys, but what happens for me sometimes is I'm reading the book and I'm not looking for new information. I'm looking for confirmation of ways that I'm already right, you know? Maybe that doesn't happen to you guys, but you know, you read through there and you're going, yeah, here's that jaywalker, you know, and then, I'm like, oh, you can't tell me anything about this page. I've already got it highlighted and underlined, you know. And what happens when I do the set aside prayer is sometimes new information will just come right off the page where you go, whoa. Where did that come from? And what happened for me, though, was I started working a program like the problem was alcohol. Now we're getting close to the topic. Now we're going to start mentioning this second surrender, because what happened for me was I was going to meetings. I had some God in my life. I did the four step. My first four step was basically just a confession of all the stuff that I felt bad about. And then I went out and made amends for some of the bad stuff that I'd done. You know, and we call them the tornado amends, where you know, that tornado roaring. I just kind of made amends to the first people touched by that tornado. But I was amazed before I was halfway through, and that list had a way of just finding its way into a drawer, and I made most of my amends. But I was going to meetings, and I thought I was a big book guy. I was going to a Tuesday night meetings, a big book study, and that sort of thing. But how do you know what you don't know? You know, I'm going along, and what happened? What I didn't realize is that I was working a program based on not drinking. And to some extent, what we call meeting-based sobriety, where the only thing I was doing was treating my alcoholism by going to meetings. By 5:30 in the day, I'm in a little discomfort. I go to the 5:30 meeting. I get a little relief. I hear what I need to hear. I go back and I'm living a life based on self-will again. And by 5:30 tomorrow, by God, I need another meeting pretty good. So I keep getting a little relief from the meetings, but I'm never experiencing the freedom that's available from this process. And I didn't know it. I thought I was an AA guy. I was very much about staying sober. It wasn't like I ever made a conscious decision to hitch my wagon to middle of the road AA or anything. I was doing the deal the way I've heard it. And I always say, be careful what we say in these AA meetings, because if the new guy hears it three or four times, he's going to think it's AA. Because the boys over at AA say all the time, you know, this is a selfish program. And you're like, really? Show that to me in the book, you know? But so. And, you know, I was that guy that's about not drinking. And, you know that guy. You've got it. You know, it's the guy that's going, well, screamed at my wife this morning and getting ready for work. And I slapped one of the kids as I was leaving. And I burned out of the driveway. And I got to work an hour late and looked at 2 hours of internet porn on the computer. And then I gambled on the internet for a while. And I left work an hour early and got a half gallon of vanilla ice cream and ate it in the front seat of the car on the way home. But I didn't drink today, and by God, that makes me a winner, you know. Well, that makes you something, but you know, what happened was I was almost always in collision with something or somebody, and I didn't know why, you know, and I'm blowing up marriages, and I'm overdrawn at the bank, and I'm having trouble in business, and at 4.5 years, I hit a wall, and I blew up a marriage, you know, and I had a baby, that now I got a child support check going out, but, you know, I waited the appropriate amount of time to get into another relationship, right, 14 days, And so I get in another relationship. So now at 7 years, I've blown up another marriage and I got another baby on the ground. And it feels like, you know, I've tried it your way and I'm getting knocked to the mat every time I step into the ring. And what happened was I went into what I call a flat period at AA, where I kind of pulled away and some dishonesty started moving into my life. And it got to where I wasn't working with others. I don't think it was an active choice, but there's something that happens in untreated alcoholism where when you share, People aren't fighting for your phone number. I always say, one of the signs, I was thinking about doing a little Jeff Foxworthy routine where instead of you might be a redneck, it'd be like you might be an untreated alcoholism. And one of the things I was going to say was, if you share in every meeting you go to and nobody ever asks for your phone number, might be an untreated alcoholism, But if you're not exactly sure where your big book is, might want to check, I'm in another marriage at this time, everything looked good from the outside. It was the proudest my mother's ever been of a marriage. We had a house in the Hamptons. We had a penthouse apartment in New York City and a beach house in the Hamptons. And one time we've chartered a plane to fly back into the city, and we're flying along in this little six-seater Cessna 210 with a charter pilot, and it was me and there were five adults and my dog, and we're going along over the Peconic Bay and... And all of a sudden, I look around, and we're in a glider, and I look over, and I'm in the co-pilot seat. I am not a co-pilot, and I look over, and what you don't want to hear from your pilot when you put on the headphones is for him to be going, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, and I'm looking at, and they come on the radio and they say, you're cleared to Gabreski. And there's an airport right there at 10 o'clock, but we're not going to make it. We're not going to clear the water. We're not going to clear the trees. And we're darn sure not going to make that runway. And he says, you don't understand. I've lost engine power. We can't make land. I'm going to have to ditch. And I'm like, what? I mean, I'm a gambler my whole life. What are the odds of that? First time I ever charter a plane, we're going to set it down at night in the water. And he turns over towards the shore and he says, brace for impact. Anybody know how to do that? And so we come in and we smash into the water. And it's like splashdown at Six Flags times 1,000. And there's water and spray and the windshield comes in. There's glass and then there's absolute silence. And all of a sudden I'm like, whoa. Now let me tell you. It was a bad time to pause because this wasn't much of an airplane, really crummy boat. About that time I feel something on my knee and it goes boop, and I go up and my door won't come open, and I go up and there's nothing but water in the roof of the plane, and I remember thinking, so that's it. I die today in this blankety blank airplane. And we go back underwater, we're completely underwater, and my door comes open, and I grab the roof of the plane, and I'd like to tell you my first thought was of my wife at the time, or my dog, or something, but my first thought was, I'm out, and I pulled myself out, and I went and got some air, and I came back down and pulled my wife out, and then I went back down and pulled the dog out, and out of five, the only non-survivor was the dog, And we did mouth-to-mouth on the dog and had him breathing for a day or two, but he'd had too much salt water. But I was on CNN with Anderson Cooper and all this stuff. And it's no Earl Hightower story, but it was pretty dramatic in my life, And it made me start looking at things differently because at this time I'm about 15, 16 years sober. And what happened was I come back to Austin and I hook up with this guy named John Henry. And I said... Because I'm looking at my life differently now, because it was almost over, Now Katie was my best friend for 20 years. Katie and I were like brother and sister for 20 years. We were litter mates in the AA, and I was at her wedding. I knew Joe. Her kids called me Uncle Charlie. We were, there was no innuendo or anything like that. I was closer than I've been with maybe three people in my life, and still am. I love you, Katie. But what happened was, why did I say that? Oh, because she had been a close observer of my levels of self-centeredness and self-obsession. Because, I was the one that would call her all the time and go, hey, I'm in the south of France, and she's like, oh, good, I didn't have time for how you doing or any of that stuff. And I called John Henry and I go, John Henry, man, I am so self-centered. That I can't even be in a conversation with somebody. I have to just force myself to go, hey, Bill, how are the kids? and act like I give a flip about the answer, because I don't. All I care about is me and me and me. And John Henry says, well, let's go over to the treatment center tomorrow and we'll talk to the winos. And you know the thing about service work? It's always what you need. It never sounds like a good idea. You know? When he's saying, we're going to go over to the detox center, you're like, they like to talk about themselves a lot, you know? I'm hoping we can get to the depth of my problems, you know? So anyway, I started going out there. Now I'm 17 years sober, and I'm working with these guys. And man, I mean, there were times where I felt like I was a step ahead of them. There were times where I'd say, you go home and read the doctor's opinion and Bill's story, and I'd go home and read the doctor's opinion and Bill's story. But at the same time, I got guys that are in this deal, and I'm starting to have different conversations. You know, now we're on the phone with people and going, what do you say when they say this? Well, that's when I'll go to this on page 24, or you point out this in the doctor's opinion, or have you ever talked about the bedevilments? No, what's that? Well, they're on page 52. Really, what do they say? You know, and you're having, and the conversations are starting to change, and the work we're doing, and we're being drawn into this work for these other people. And I go to Myers, who some of you know Myers. He's got a one-eyed brother that named Chris, and those two guys changed my life. You know, I went up there and I went to Myers, and I went through the steps with him, and then we started doing stuff, and we started this primary purpose group in Austin. You know, in a big book study, we'd seen the one up in Dallas, and we're like, we need to have one of these, and now we're studying the book, and we're doing this stuff, and I mean. About that time, Mark Houston came into our life. Katie and I found a flyer, and we went up to Denton to this Big Book experience. And I mean, let me tell you something. There was a time when I wouldn't have been real fired up about going to a Big Book meeting, but this is a Big Book weekend. What? You know, we're going to talk about the Big Book Friday night, all day Saturday, Sunday morning. Oh, boy. You know? And I'm telling you, it changed my life. Mark was up there talking. And there was a point where I leaned over to Katie and I said, my God, what book is he reading from? I mean, because there was stuff coming out of there, and I mean, and it was the Big Book Alcoholics Anonymous. And so what happened was we started, you know, well, I want to go back to the way I'm doing the steps now, because what had happened in that first time is we went from A, are you alcoholic, to B, probably no human power could relieve your alcoholism, and see that God could and would if he were sought. And that's where, for some reason, we've started chanting like a bunch of kids in summer camp these days. I don't want to go on a big rant, but all I'm going to tell you is that the chanting is optional. You know, I mean, oh my God, when I came in, they would say, at the Lord's Prayer, they'd go, keep coming back, you know. And then it got to be, well, keep coming back, it works. And then it was, keep coming back, it works if you work it, and you're worth it, so work it. And you're like, oh, for God's sake, you know, I mean, you know. You know, I always picture the new guy coming in going, God almighty, I really want to stop drinking whiskey, but do I really have to do all this shave and a haircut, two bits, you know, and God could and would if he were sought. We're the only group of people that can take the Lord's Prayer and we think, well, I think we can put a little better ending on it. You know, I think I can do this prayer a little bit better than Jesus did it. You know, Don't get offended by that. I swear to God, you can talk about it. Buddhism, Hinduism, American Indian spiritualism, you name it, you know, Sufism, Wiccan, but you mention Jesus, and they go, what? I'm not saying, I'm just saying, but you know, because I understand. Both sides of that deal, you know. I used to bristle with antagonism, you know, at the mere mention of any of that stuff. But anyway, what happened was, I went from A, that I was alcoholic and could not manage my own. And what I saw happen is going from C, that God could and would if he were sought, to the third step prayer. Are you alcoholic? Do you believe there's a power that could move you beyond where you are? And if so, let's get down on our knees and do the third step prayer. I think it's one of the biggest mistakes being made in Alcoholics Anonymous is we go right from, are you alcoholic? Is there a God that can help you? To doing a third step prayer and writing inventory. If you do that, now, if you do that, you skip this body of work from pages 60 to 63. It's really not very important. It's just the root of our problem and the basis of my recovery for the rest of my life. But you know, other than that, just skip it, you know? And so when I'm talking about this selfishness and self-centeredness that I'm talking to John Henry about, I'm reading the book one day, I've done the set-aside prayer, and after that A, B, and C, it says, You know what it says after that A, B, and C? The next line says, being convinced, we were at step three. Being convinced of what? A, B, and C. So it tells me that A, B, and C do a pretty good job of summing up one and two. Because being convinced of those, I'm at step three, which is I'm going to turn my will and my life over to the care of God. What do we mean by that? What do we do? Those are fair questions for the new guy to be asking me. When you say I'm going to turn my will and my life over, what do you mean? What do you want me to do? And here's the one that blew me away. One day it just came up off the page and it said, the first requirement is that we be convinced that any life on self-will can hardly be a success. And I remember looking at that and going, good grief, where did that come from? Because not only had I never been convinced of that, that line had never touched me, because we had gone right from see that God couldn't, and went to the third step prayer, and we skipped over this piece. And it's a, so I like to turn these statements into questions in the book, and I like to go first person with it. You know, saying the first requirement is that Charlie be convinced that Charlie's life run on Charlie's will can hardly be a success. And I've written in my book right here, are you convinced? Because when we get over to the fourth step, it says being convinced that self manifested in various ways is what had defeated us. We look for its common manifestations. So that tells me somewhere between 60 and 64, the book has done a job of convincing me that my life run on self-will can hardly be a success. Now we're getting into this second surrender thing. It talks about on the basis of self-will, I'm almost always in collision with something or somebody, right? And it talks about that actor running the whole show. And the reason that actor is such a pain in the neck is because he's just an actor. He's not the director. He's not supposed to be calling the shots. But that's what we do. My God, watch an AA conference sometime. Watch how many people adjust the thermostat. You know, I mean, watch. We walk in. You know, I swear to God. You know what some people do when they go in the post office? There's a big line. They just stand in line. Oh, my God, you can spot the alcoholic from a mile away. We're the one in there going, oh, come on. There's nine stations here. You got one checker. What is the deal? You know, who put the potato chips over here? You know, and you know, because I'm running everything, you know. That's the way self-will shows up for me. And the way it shows up is I'm the guy in the grocery store, and I'm going, you know, there's the guy in front of me, he's got 14 items on the 10-item lane, and the reason I know it is because I counted every stinking one of them, you know. And, you know, and I'm the guy on a bad day when self-will is strong in me. I'm the one going, okay, pal, which four of those items you want to put back? You know, and if he comes back with the wrong answer, it's a bad day at the grocery store, you know, because next thing you know, I'm explaining to my family how I got arrested buying milk, you know. Somebody's got to say something, though, you know. I mean, there's chaos in our society. Well, so what happens is, you know, this thing about self-will, and it talks about, you know, the toolkit of self-will, and I wish I had more time to go into this, but that I'm kind and modest and self-sacrificing, unless that doesn't work, and then I'm mean, egotistic, and overbearing, but it's all me trying to get things to go my way. I'm going to be nice over here, I'm going to be mean over here, and what usually happens, the show doesn't come off very well. Well, so what happened for me was I'm out there managing my butt off, and not only was I not convinced that my life run on self-will could hardly be a success, but if you followed me around, you would have been able to tell that this boy is not convinced that his life run on self-will can hardly be a success. I look like a guy that thinks, now that you've got the booze off of me, I'll take it from here. You know, 12 and 12 says we can have faith in God, but keep him out of our lives. And the way that shows up for me is God consciousness starts dropping down, self-will starts rising up, and before long, God doesn't have anything to do with it. And I'm the guy that's going, oh, God's awesome, man. God's awesome. He took away my drinking problem. That's really, now, I don't need him for this deal with my marriage. And I don't need him for this deal at work. And I don't need him for this thing with the Internal Revenue Service, or I don't need him this thing with my kids. But if I ever come across a really big problem, by God, I'm going to bring God right in here, you know. But in the meantime, take a knee, God. I'll take it from here, you know. And that's the way I was running my life. And I was always in collision with something or somebody, and I didn't know it. I didn't know the problem I had when I was blowing up those marriages, and I thought I was running up against the failure of Alcoholics Anonymous. I thought, I've tried it your way, and I'm getting knocked to the mat every time I step into the ring. I didn't have anybody in my life saying, Charlie, you're not running up against the failure of Alcoholics Anonymous, you're running up against the failure of self-will. this is what it looks like when you try to run the show yourself sober. You know, what happens for a guy like me, the second surrender is not, you know, the first surrender is the surrender to alcohol, but the second surrender is the surrender to self. The surrender to self-will. And we can talk to the new guy about selfishness and self-centeredness being the root of your problem, and they nod their head like they know what we're talking about. They don't know what we're talking about. You know why? Because at 30 years sober, I'm still shocked by the level of self-will that goes on in me. Is it any surprise that I didn't move when, oh my God. There was no question whether I was going to move because of that lightning coming last night. I mean, you know, Doug was like, did you move back up in the stands? I'm like, oh, sure. Yeah. Yeah. Self-will run riot, you know. So what happens is the selfishness, self-centeredness, now when we start sponsoring some guys, and I'm almost done here, you know, when we start sponsoring guys now my work is not about not drinking. This changes everything. It blows my whole program and my whole work into looking for manifestations of self. How do I show up? How do people experience me? How do I run the show? How do I play God? Well, part of it is I know how everything needs to go, and I know how much money I should have, and who should be alive, and who should be dead, and how long people should live, and who should be sick, and who shouldn't, and what job I should get, and all that sort of thing. And the deal we make in step three is that I'm no longer in management, right? And it's amazing to me how much stuff in my life are management level decisions, and I'm no longer in management. The level of self-will that I carry around in my life, I mean, one time I walked in the AA club and there was a guy standing there and he goes, hey, Charlie, how you doing? I go, hey, what's up, Steve? And he goes, hey, we need to go back out to Vegas sometime. And I go, yeah, yeah. And I turn around and I am horrified because I got no memory of ever being in Vegas with this guy, right? And I'm 15 years sober at this time. But as I started running through my brain, I realized that there was a trip to Vegas one time. It was four men, and we went out there, and we played golf, and we gambled, and we got massages, and we, you know, just knocked around. But the reason I didn't remember being in Vegas with this guy was because I wasn't in Vegas with this guy. I was in Vegas with me. And this guy just happened to be one of those people out here on the periphery, you know? Bob Bazans talks about his sponsor, told me, he goes, Bob, you know those shadowy figures out there? He goes, those are people, you know? They have lives and families and concerns of their own, you know? And you're like, what? You know, because people don't write me as the star of their show. Well, now we're looking for manifestations of self and the way it shows up, and it changes. Now I can sponsor a lot of guys because I'm not trying to be their life coach. When they're calling me, you know, it says what usually happens. The show didn't come off very well. Well, that's most of my 10-step calls right there is when they call me, you go, let me guess, the show didn't come off very well. You know, you become angry, indignant, self-pity. Now this whole thing, now in the 4th step, we're looking for manifestations of self. The way self manifests in a guy like me is in resentment, in fears, sex, and harms to others. Then in 6 and 7, what I used to do was look at the stuff in inventory, but this vigorous course of action is like a golf swing. And I used to just do 4 and 5 and I'd feel better. 4 and 5 and I'd feel better. Maybe I'd make some amends. But what we do now is you look at the stuff in the 4th step. I take it to somebody and God in the 5th step. And what we do in the 5th step is I see how self manifests for a guy like me. I see how people experience me. And then I just decide if it's objectionable to me. And if it's objectionable to me, do I have the power to change it on my own? And if I don't have the power to change it on my own, then am I willing for God to change it in whatever way He sees fit? And if that's the case, then I take that willingness into the 7th step and I ask God to change it and make me useful. And then I go out and I make amends for the harms that I've done out of that level of self-centeredness. That's 4 through 9. Like that. And that's the vigorous course of action. And then in the 10th step, I'm watching. The 10th step is not the evening review. There's the 12 and 12 that in the 10th step, it covers all the different ways that we do inventory, but the evening review in the big book is in the 11th step. And what the 10th step is a spot check inventory of watching how self manifests for me as I go through the day. And then in the evening review, I see how good of a job did I do in the 10th step. And then I take those considerations into my morning meditation. And throughout the day, I'm turning back to the line, turning back to the line, turning back to the line. It's the proper use of the will. And then I go out and I try to practice these principles. All I can tell you is for the last 13 years, my life has exploded. In the third step, it says, stay close to him and perform his work well, and he'll provide what you need. And all I can tell you is up to now, God's been doing a pretty awesome job of keeping up his end of the deal. You know, this thing, this surrender to self, for most of us, it usually doesn't come on our first talk with our sponsor. The surrender to self usually comes after we've run up against the failure of self-will several times in sobriety. You know, we hear things in meetings, we hear stuff from our sponsor, and we try to manage it, and then finally one day you go, wow, you know, if a mere code of morals or a better philosophy of life were sufficient to get me over this stuff, most of us would have stopped it a long time ago, but the needed power wasn't there. I got to go to God with this stuff. You know, is it objectionable? Looking at, so, I mean, the level this takes into things, I'm just got a couple minutes, I swear I'm done. The stuff we do with these guys now, I mean, I'm out in Idaho one time, and this guy that they'd sent, just like Jeff's been driving us around, we had this guy, and he's a really sweet guy, but we're talking about selfishness, self-centeredness, root of our problem, manifestations of self, all this stuff. Look at the book. It's amazing, you know. And so we get over to this guy's house, and this guy's talking about his relationships, and he goes, oh, my first wife, boy, that chick was crazy, man. God almighty, I mean, she was, woo! And he goes, my second wife, I mean, she was nuts, you know? And then this chick I just broke up with about 4 months ago, he goes, I mean, she was riding on the hood of the car, holding on the windshield wipers, and we're sitting there, and his sponsor's there and everything, and I go, Brian, you mind if I ask you a couple of questions? And he goes, no, go ahead. And I go, how is it you find yourself in relationship with all these crazy women? And he goes, what do you mean? And I said, well, were they crazy when you met them? Or is it possible that the only difference between the way they were when you met them and the way they were when you divorced them was the effect of spending this amount of time with somebody as selfish and self-centered as you are? And his sponsor was sitting behind him, and his sponsor goes, say that again. You know? Now one of the biggest promises in the big book comes true for me, and that's that my problems are basically of my own making. This stuff can rewrite history. If you'd asked me what happened in my first marriage, I would have told you she cheated on me, and I don't roll like that. If you ask me now, I would tell you that I exhibited a level of selfishness and self-centeredness in that marriage that would have driven anybody crazy and would have driven anybody out the door. Now I come into this inventory with a resentment, and I come out the other ends with an amends to go make. It is freeing stuff. It happens, and I almost missed it. If I'd have died in that plane crash, I would have missed it. If you'd have come to me when I had 17 years and said, Charlie, what's going to change your life and set you on fire is the program of Alcoholics Anonymous right out of the big book, I would have told you, you're crazy, man. I've been in AA for 17 years. I know what AA has to offer me. I'm an NFL football fan. I assume we're all Dallas Cowboy fans here. I know my Philly boys are here, but I've been a fan of the Cowboys since they were good. And what? One time, this guy invited me to go sit in a skybox, and we go up in this skybox, and we go in a special entrance, up a special escalator, and they got ice and cookies, and it's all civilized. And I'm sitting in there, and I don't know whether to be excited about being in the skybox or to be angry about having sat in the cheap seats for 20 years. But that was exactly my experience in Alcoholics Anonymous. After 17 years of thinking I knew what the deal was, I found out there was a whole another level of the deal. Now here's the thing I want to close out with this weekend. Here's one problem that I've seen. We're all seekers in here. We're all people that are trying to do the deal, but one of the things that I see happen is we come to a weekend like this and we hear the solution and we get up next to the solution and we get excited about the solution and we get right up next to the solution and then we go back home and we fall back into our lives. We go home and it's the kids and it's the job and it's this thing like that. You know, there's a lot of message of hope out there for the newcomer in Alcoholics Anonymous. And if you're new, we're glad you're here and we hope you become a part of our lives. But I'm telling you, I'm here talking to the guy that's got 3 years, 5 years, 15 years, 25 years, and you're not feeling it. I've had guys come up to me and tell me they're ready to blow their brains out at 16 years, 23 years of sobriety. I'm here to tell you, it's still available, and it's available as a result of doing the work right out of the big book with somebody who's done the work right out of the big book. Uh, Our book says the most satisfactory years of our existence lie ahead of us. Ask yourself, is that your belief? Is that your experience? If not, get with somebody and do the work. If you are, let's get out there and carry the message. We know you won't want to miss it. My name's Charlie Parker. I'm an alcoholic.